What's going on, everybody? Happy Friday. Welcome to another Quickcast here on the AADOM Facebook page. Thank you for joining us. And like it has been for these Friday Quickcasts, we bring on companies. They talk about their products and services. What's really unique about today is we are very excited to have with us Jennie McLaughlin, who's the Director of Compliance from Cedr. And so we're going to talk about what they do best, which is HR and so many of the good things that you guys have heard from them really over this last year and even beyond that. You know, they've been with AADOM for a long time, but we got through 2020. Now we're in 2021, and it still feels like, Jennie, there's some of these lingering things that managers need to be looking out for, understanding, and certainly nobody better than the work that you guys do at Cedr. So, Jennie, it's good to have you. Thanks for coming on.
Thanks, John. Good to be here.
All right. So what we're going to do is Jennie has some content to share. And she's going to go through that. And please, like we've been doing, let us know in the comments thread where you're watching from. If you have any specific questions about what she's going to talk about, please put those in there. And then once she's done with her little mini presentation, we'll come back. I've got some questions for her. We know you may have some questions. We'll make sure that she gets those answered and enjoy the Quickcast. So Jennie, the floor is yours.
Great. Thanks, everyone. Good to see you here today. We're going to just do a little, recap about what's going on with HR and COVID today, which I'm sure you're all used to, maybe different from a week ago, maybe different next week. So let's just go over some things. And as John said, I'm Jennie. I'm our Director of Compliance. This is a picture of me with slightly different hair. Here at Cedr, I'm really in charge of making sure we are on top of all of the changing employment laws across the country and that we're giving, good guidance around that. I also, of course, help make business decisions for our company and I manage a lot of people. So just like you, I'm needing to make practical decisions around all of these changing employment laws and pandemic circumstances. And so we use that as managers here so that we know what would we do if the situation an AADOM manager is bringing us, what would you do if that was our employee? And that's really how we try to help you guys out and give you some good options. We've been working with AADOM a long time. We are AADOM's HR business partner and help them with their internal HR. But if you're not familiar with us, we're basically a remote HR support program. So we can help you create a custom employee handbook that's compliant with your state, federal, county, and city laws in many cases. And if you have a membership, you can contact us as much or as little as you want for any type of HR issues that come up. I help manage our HR team, and we're just here to help, make things easier for you guys and track all those laws so you guys don't have to. And we also have an HR software suite where we've got an online vault, which allows you for online personnel record keeping, time tracking, PTO tracking, HIPAA training, and a lot of other things in there for you. And it says at the very bottom, our mission statement is we believe better workplaces make better lives. We all spend so much of our time at work that we want to make sure it goes well for the employee and the employer. So just people have a better life and we avoid lawsuits that could kind of muck those waters up. So today, I just want to very quickly run through the most common things we're answering questions about here in our Cedr Solution Center about vaccines, current policies and documentation you need, what's going on with paid leave, and we're still seeing a lot of lingering, childcare issues. In prepping for this a month ago, we didn't know what would be going on today because things keep changing. So current events. As it happens this week, I'm hearing that we're getting more vaccines approved, maybe some booster shots coming, which means maybe things can start slowly going back to normal. I know I'm talking to a group of people who work in clinical offices, so all of you are likely either vaccinated or already had the opportunity to get vaccinated. Which is great. But as you know, your patient base and your visitors to the office aren't yet. I'm still fingers crossed when I can get vaccinated. And when that happens, I've got to go work in the office again. And my dogs, who may interfere with this presentation, will probably have a problem with that. In other news, just yesterday, we got some updates out of Congress. So we've all been kind of waiting to see if there's going to be any new COVID care packages. Like last year, there was a lot of, we had the PPP loans, the Family First Coronavirus Response Act, FFCRA, which mandated that you provide paid leave for many of your employees. If you're not aware, FFCRA technically expired on December 31st, but they went ahead and made it optional through the end of this coming March, which means if an employee didn't use up all of their FFCRA leave and they have a qualifying event for it, you can opt to give them that paid leave and still get the tax credit for it through the end of March. So we've been encouraging people to go ahead and do that because you want to have people still let you know if they're infected, exposed, caring for a family members, keep them out of the office and still give them the paid leave that you get the tax credit back for. The question has been, are they ever going to extend that? Are they going to mandate it? You know, what's going to happen? The current relief package that Congress has been working on has been wanted to add in an increase of the federal minimum wage into that package, and others did not. They made just an administrative congressional decision yesterday that they will not move forward with putting the $15 minimum wage in as part of this particular relief package, which means I don't know for sure what that's going to mean, but what we're seeing is that the Biden administration and others are really pushing toward making the FFCRA mandatory again, meaning it's not optional, it's mandatory with a few changes, but nothing that should significantly impact you guys too much. Since it'll be basically the same relief package, you all already know what to do, or you know where to find those resources. You know when to call Cedr. All the same people remain eligible, except for the fact that Biden administration wants to kill those exemptions. So there is a small business exemption and a healthcare provider exemption, which are both technically very hard to use anyway. They want to wipe those. So just make it mandatory to provide paid leave for everybody and still get the tax credit for it. They also, and I don't think this will impact too many of you, maybe none of you, currently the FFCRA is only for employers with 500 or fewer employees, which seems bad. You know, why are they making the small employers pay for this? But it was actually meant to help you guys because they're saying if you're a larger company, you probably already offer a lot of paid leave, or you should, and you have the resources to do it. If you're smaller, we're going to help you do it by giving you a tax credit for it. What the Biden administration wants to do is make paying for leave mandatory for everyone. So even those large companies like a Walmart or a Starbucks, but you still only get the tax credit back from the government if you're less than 500 employees. Because if you're larger, you should have your own resources to be able to do that. Again, I suspect all of you are less than 500, so it won't really matter. So really the only changes we're looking for you guys is it going to continue to be mandatory or become mandatory again? And are those exemptions going away? And we'll continue to keep you guys up to date with that, but it could even be as soon as next week or the week after that there's updates on that. In the meantime, FFCRA remains optional through the end of March. So let's talk about vaccines. So let me just skip to the second thing on the slide. The main things we get asked about is making vaccines mandatory and what about paid leave. So we get a lot of people who are concerned that the vaccine has been made available to all of your team and some people have chosen not to get it for a variety of reasons. But then the issue is, okay, so they could have gotten the vaccine, they didn't, and now they're sick with COVID. Do I still have to give them paid time off when this was easily preventable? Short answer is yes. I mean, we don't want you to kind of pick and choose who is eligible for paid benefits based on what kind of medical decisions they're making based on vaccines. If you deny paid leave for some people because they didn't get vaccinated, you could run into a problem where, you know, the person has an immunodeficiency where their doctor says it's not safe for you to get this. Now they're sick and you're treating them less well. They don't get as many benefits as others because of this underlying medical issue. Other issue is with if you have mandatory paid sick leave in your state, city, or county, It's probably going to be considered illegal to deny them the ability to use their earned sick leave under state law if they have a qualifying event, which would be being sick. And even if you don't, even if we're not talking about FFCRA, we're not talking about mandatory leave, and you just choose to offer people vacation, sick, or PTO benefits, if you were to not let them use it when technically under their policies, your policies, they should qualify, that could actually be considered withholding wages, because many states will consider an earned and accrued time off benefit to be wages. So denying them to get paid under circumstances where they technically should be could just load you in a whole lot of other trouble. So just stay away from trying to deny paid leave, even though I get it. You know, this person could have gotten vaccinated and they could have been at work instead of needing to be out for, you know, potentially weeks at a time. So I certainly understand, but it's just not something we recommend doing. And so what about avoiding that entirely and saying, okay, I require you to get a vaccine to be able to work here? There's some laws out there in the EEOC guidance basically suggesting, yes, you could make it mandatory, but there are huge exceptions to that, which makes it not really mandatory in practical senses. So even if you say, I want you to get vaccinated with any type of medical thing like that, someone may come back and not be able to for a medical reason or even a religious exception to it. And you're going to need to try to accommodate around those things. And can you accommodate that? I'm going to say yes. I mean, speaking as someone who is an attorney who used to sue employers for employer discrimination, it would be pretty easy to come after you for firing someone for not getting a vaccine because you deem them unsafe to work in the office. Because if it was unsafe to work in the office while unvaccinated, you should have been closed this entire past year because it was too unsafe to be working. Instead, you've basically proved the fact that wearing proper PPE is a good accommodation and eliminates risk. And why can't a person continue to wear PPE and work in the office, especially considering you're patient-based, which means your patients aren't all vaccinated either. So you're always in contact with unvaccinated people. So it's not really reasonable to say it's impossible for you to work here if you're not vaccinated. Now, there could be exceptions in some industries. There might be if you provide functions in a hospital or a prison. There's often state laws that mandate different types of standards. And that's just a little bit different. I will point out that a lot of hospitals in the past have had state rules mandating the flu vaccine. And for people who truly can't get it, there's usually an accommodation. And that accommodation is moving them so they're not working in the ICU and instead they're working at the front desk or in a different department where it's a different level of care. The other one is they wear a mask. You know, you would normally probably be wearing the mask working on a patient, but these people might be required to wear a mask no matter what they're doing within the facility. And that's something you guys have already been doing. So again, these reasonable accommodations are there. And for that reason, we really push you to really encourage the vaccine, do what you can to make it available, educate people about it, but leave things open to people having, you know, some concerns about it at this time. We've even been seeing some recent attorneys dig up some OSHA opinion letters saying that an employee could reasonably refuse to get the flu vaccine or other vaccinations if they have a reasonable belief it might cause them some sort of health care harm. And so with so much unknown about the COVID vaccine that we're seeing, we think OSHA would also say it's reasonable for someone to have health concern risks about getting it and for you to run into trouble with OSHA if you try to force it on people. So those are the main things we're hearing about vaccines right now. And just keep those things in mind. Try to be reasonable and practical for your teams. So what about documentation? We're getting a lot of requests for people wanting to document the fact that someone's not getting the vaccine. To be blunt, we don't know why. What do you need the record for? Anytime you looked at doing documentation, it's important to look at what you need it for and why you're asking for it. So you're not, to our knowledge, being required to vaccinate people or being required to maintain vaccination records like maybe you do with hepatitis B. So why do you need a record of someone's vaccination? If you didn't do it in the past for other types of vaccines, there's really no reason to do it here. You also don't want someone signing something, a release or liability waiver, if they decline the vaccine. You can't waive your liability. That really won't do anything other than show you believed that they were a risk to the office and allowed them to work anyway. You don't want to have that liability waiver turned against you. If you've offered to arrange for everyone to get vaccinated, some people say no. Maybe you record that the offer was made and who said yes or who said no, just so you have it. But there's really no reason to have vaccine records or declination forms in your paperwork at this time. There may be some state requirements you guys do need to be aware of if there is COVID exposure in the office. So as usual, we're looking at you, California. California comes up with the rule for everything. And so in 2021, they actually, Cal OSHA has some pretty strict rules about reporting to your employees and patients about any potential COVID exposure. So as usual, as we were saying before, if a person who works there or a patient that you saw gets COVID or may have been exposed, continue contacting your state public health department to see what they recommend that you do and if there's any mandatory reporting that you need to do. And same goes with your health and safety protocols. Keep an eye on the alerts from those organizations. We've seen California, I think Michigan and Virginia have some pretty strict protocols about what you need to have written down for, you know, COVID safety and health issues. So you would just want to make sure that you remain on top of those things. As far as paid and unpaid leave, well, I've touched on what's going on with FFCRA. Like I said, I do think that they're going to continue extending it. We think it'll probably become mandatory again, but no guarantees there. Do be aware that there are some states and even cities who have passed their own COVID relief laws. And that's really what happens when the feds can't get it together. So since the federal government didn't officially extend FFCRA, the states and cities come in and come up with their own relief. And by doing that, they're saying employers have to provide paid time off for COVID. The bad part about that is that they can't give you a tax credit back. So this literally comes out of your pocket. So really the best case scenario is for the federal government to do the tax credit extension further than March, so that if you're providing that paid leave, you can at least get it back. If they don't extend it, it wouldn't surprise me if more states and cities start requiring that you pay out of pocket for COVID leave. There's a few cities in California that have their own laws. There's a California state law, and Colorado has a pretty extensive one as well. So just be aware of those. And as usual, if you're a Cedr member, if something comes up, continue calling us. We get so many emails and calls just saying, hey, this is what happened. I'm pretty sure you still just have optional FICRA pay. Let me know if anything changed, because things can change day to day. And again, it's probably better for everybody if FFCRA becomes extended, but we'll see. When it comes to childcare, and I can speak as a manager, I've got employees on my teams who have childcare needs because they're not fully back in school yet. Again, they could get 2 weeks of FFCRA sick leave and then 10 weeks of FFCRA childcare needs for a total of 12 weeks if they haven't already used it up. That being said, letting someone have a lot of time off for childcare, which might be 12 consecutive weeks, it might be a few days at a time, it might be 2 days a week, that can be really, really difficult. And this has been going on for coming up on a year now. So even if you're offering to continue paying the 2 weeks of FFCRA sick leave while it's optional, it would be okay to deny it for childcare because it's a different type of leave and you're not required to do it anymore. Or even deny it for certain people who are just, you know, a single department or something. I don't necessarily recommend it in all cases because it's not always going to fix the childcare problem. But outside of FFCRA, which again is optional right now, there's generally not employment protection for not having childcare. So someone who simply is unable to work because they don't have school or daycare or a babysitter, you technically don't have to accommodate that. So you could put them on an extended personal leave rather than dealing with them coming in and out of the office, or you could even let them go. But we'd recommend first talking to them to see, is there an end in sight? Is there a fix you see coming? Because it can be much harder to replace someone than to just give them another month or so to get things together and have them come back. So really keep those things in mind. But childcare is generally not protected, so you do have a lot more leeway now. And we've been working with a lot of managers who are having to make tough decisions around that. And we certainly understand. And like I said, I'm a manager. I've dealt with it. I don't like to tell someone that their job's at risk or we can't accommodate because they have kids, because it's out of their control. But you do have a business to run. And so we're here to partner with you to decide how to make those decisions. And outside of that, I'm going to leave it open to John and anyone else who has some questions. But I do just want you guys to know that even if you are a Cedr member, but especially if you're not, up on the screen, HR Basecamp, that's a free Facebook group that we invite you to join. You can talk to each other about HR issues just like you do in the AADOM group. And myself and Paul Edwards, our CEO, pipe in there with a lot of guidance as well. And we post a lot of updates there, along with providing them over to AADOM.
Thanks, Jennie. Good stuff. Sure. You know, we say this often on these quick cast, live casts, anything that we ever do, it's, you know, sometimes we get a lot of great questions. And in many cases, our guests, you know, as in yourself, you know, share so much great information that I think at the moment there's no questions. I know the team has put some links in there. Right. And so I always say that, cause it's like really no questions, but what it usually means is that you covered a lot of things, which you guys always do at Cedr, you know, to really help the audience with a lot of those things that they're dealing with. I do have one question that I'm just curious about. What has it been like now that I cannot believe it's almost March in 2021, but what has it been like in, I guess, what we'll call this new phase of, you know, it's been almost a year and practices have learned so much, but what has it been like with and you guys working with practices with how they're handling these things now versus last year? Do you guys feel like, wow, I mean, there was an eye-opening when it came to just HR issues in general in a practice, but are you seeing this trend of people really paying attention more than ever just because of what happened?
Yeah, I actually think it's pretty astounding how on top of things people are. I mean, we've noticed, like I said, we customize handbooks, we update them. We've never had this many people asking to make changes to their handbooks or asking for compliance checks on it because they're so into making sure things are done right. So it's keeping us way busier than we've ever been, but in a really good way. And people are really just, like I said, they know FFCRA is optional. They're just double checking. Hey, it's still optional, right? This is what we do. As opposed to, someone's sick. What do I do? I've never heard of this before. People are really educated and managers have really done an amazing job at growing this year.
Yeah, it feels like the confidence level is way up, which we know is huge. And I think as we've seen with so many companies, yours included, that a lot of the things that you guys do, a lot of other companies do, like with different products and services, is, you know, they were talking about practices about things like this. It was just very, very difficult for those practices to, you know, have a little bit of time to dig in and really see sometimes the value of it. So it's so encouraging to hear you say that. I was curious, you know, just the confidence level around these types of items in a dental practice. If, you know, more and more practices are feeling good about how to address things ahead of time, that's awesome. So that's good to hear.
Yeah,
excellent. Well, thank you so much for your time on a Friday. I know everybody appreciates all of you over at Cedr and the information that you share today. Like it always is, everybody. A lot of times the members from the AADOM team and the Cedr team can get into the thread there. If you guys have any specific questions for them, these videos will be up for a while so that you can get access to them. And Jennie, we appreciate your time.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, John. Thanks, AADOM. And yeah, people have questions, we'll be monitoring, as always, happy to help and provide updates as they come in.
Excellent. Have a great weekend, everybody.
Thanks. Bye.